name's Frank Tusa. I was born in Brooklyn, Canarsie, in 1964. I'm 53 now. Now I work for the Logan School Bus Company in the Bronx. I build custom motorcycles, custom race cars. I just build things, fix everything. For the first 4 years of my life, I lived in Canarsie. And I remember when I was 4 years old. A lot of people don't remember when they were four, but I do, clearly. Then we moved to Long Island. I remember the day we moved there. We moved to Merrick. It was fun growing up. For kids, it was a good neighborhood.
Growing up with Frankie was, you know, as a kid, he was a good kid. He was pretty, like, quiet, kept to himself. But as he got older, he, you know, he was just a typical boy. Did boy stuff, got into trouble, but mostly at school.
I quit school in 11th grade for no reason. But I wound up going back, and I quit again. So I was a little uncomfortable not having an education on paper, so I took my GED, a test in the street, and I got it. But then, a couple years later, I wound up going to prison. And when you go into that system, they automatically put you into school programming so they can get funded. So I had to do school all over again. My uncle got me into this lifestyle. He used to have me take cars and do insurance jobs so they can get paid. During that, a guy asked me to deliver an envelope of money in Long Island. So I went and delivered it. And when I delivered it, the guy was a little nervous about accepting this money, which is not my business, but that was that. But he wound up pulling a gun on me. So I tried to leave. So when I left, he came after me, shooting a gun at me. So I had a rifle in the car, and I took that out and defended myself. I shot back a warning shot. But when I shot the warning shot, I didn't realize that the guy is behind the muzzle flash of his gun. So when I shot towards that, I didn't realize he was behind it, so the bullet wound up hitting him. So that's what caused my incarceration.
I was in the house when they came, and Frankie was outside, and there were about nine policemen who had him on the ground with guns to his head. My reaction was horror, frightened. I thought they were going to kill him, and then I just couldn't believe what they said he did.
Well, when I first found out he got arrested, I was very upset, along with my whole family. And then the first time I saw him at the courthouse, you know, I was sad seeing him there going to court for something that we weren't sure he was guilty of. You know, we didn't know anything at that point, you know, at the beginning. And then, you know, when we visited him, it was just very emotional because it was like, you know, you're visiting him, you're talking about it, and then the next thing you know, you have to leave him behind. So it was very sad.
Survival in prison is multiple levels of everything and anything. It's basically day by day how to survive in prison. Just deal what comes your way. You carry yourself like a gentleman, you'll be dealt with like a gentleman. But then you got idiots with no education that want to try you and see what you're about and make a name for themselves. And fighting is a regular in there. And it's just, you got to cook for yourself because the prison food is disgusting. But there's a lot of things, like, there's a lot of homicides in there, there's a lot of drugs, a lot of violence, a lot of racial tension, and it's just, you gotta live day by day.
It wasn't a good feeling in there, that's for sure, and you look around and you see all those people, all the mothers and all the wives and all the children, and I look at my son thinking, how did he get here? But then leaving would be very hard. I couldn't think of leaving him there every time I visited. But I did it for a lot of years. 27.
It was hard because, you know, then we had holidays and birthdays and, you know, and he wasn't there, and it was hard not having him in the family pictures and just doing the family things. It just was very hard and emotional.
Well, I can go on for the next 5 months telling you about experiences in prison. But one of the worst, when I was locked in a cell, 6x9 steel cell with another inmate with a knife, and I had to fight this guy. And one of us had to leave that cell. That was pretty hairy. Because there was a lot of blood, a lot of fighting. It was a survival. It's like worse than being in Iraq. This was a real test of life right there. Tony put the razor blade up. I put my hands up. I won.
He was angry being in there because he was being mistreated. Not only him. He would tell me what things going on. How they were treated for no reason. They would come into his cell and destroy his property.
Well, I got treated with a lot of respect because I carry myself as a man. That's me. But you always got somebody that's got to make a problem because they're jealous of you being, you know, walking that with your head up high. They get jealous of that.
First of all, I was so excited when I knew that he was finally getting released because I know firsthand what his family went through. His mom, his sisters, his brother. I mean, everybody was so upset. Like, the whole ordeal, it was a lifetime. It's a lifetime. He missed, like, most of his lifetime. And just what everything was, especially his mom. I mean, I've seen what she went through and how she was. So knowing that he was coming home, it was so exciting. And, of course, I'm going to get emotional because it was really exciting. But I was so happy to see him. And, I remember when he walked in, we were all waiting, we walked in, and we had like a little party get-together thing, and it was great. He was so happy seeing everybody. And you could tell it was a little awkward for him because he was, wow, I'm finally out. But he looked great, and I was just happy for the whole family. Everybody was emotional.
I thought being released from prison would be like a really big thing, but since the last 3 years of my incarceration, I worked in an outside clearance crew. So I would go out every morning, leave prison, get on the tractor and go cut grass at the libraries, churches, and whatnot. So when I got released from prison, it didn't feel that, you know, different until I started driving down a block and not coming back. That was the big difference. But coming home was nice. It was like a big relief. It's like, all right, all the past is the past now. You know, the worst part's behind me. So now I got to start, you know, working again and building up a future.
I was very excited. I couldn't wait to hold him on the other side of the wall, the free air. His boss and all his co-workers that when he worked there, they were all there, happy to see him being released. He was happy, excited, and it was good to get him in the car and drive away. Then we went to the house where he was arrested at. It was like he never left. It was like he walked up the walk into his house again.
You know, it was overwhelming because it was too much to take in like one day. You know, I was just the night before I was sleeping in a cold metal cell. Now I'm sleeping in a room with, you know, sheetrock walls and a wooden door. So, you know, it felt weird. But it was nice being home with my family.
I think it was a little rough start because being in jail that long, you know, you come out to the real world and it's a struggle. I know he was struggling a little in the beginning. It's hard because you have to learn how to deal with people again. And, you know, you're in the outside world. You're not stuck in, you know, behind bars.
The biggest thing, you're going to laugh, is patience. Because in jail, you got to wait for everything. When you go to commissary to buy your little coffee and your little cold cuts and stuff, you're going to wait 4 hours in a hallway just to buy $3 worth of garbage. So you learn patience and you learn how to, I don't know how to word it. You appreciate life a lot more when you get out because you can go to jail real easy for the stupidest reason, not even know it. But to go to jail is real simple. To get out, it's hard because you got to deal with a parole panel. If they don't feel that you're going to go out there and do the right thing, they're not going to let you out. So you learn. You learn how to take orders or respect laws and rules. But you learn. You learn patience and had to deal with all walks of life. Because in there, I dealt with every walk of life known to man.
What I really want for him is to be happy and enjoy his life now. I want him to... Any dreams or wishes he's had that he was never able to achieve, or, you know, dream, like, successes that he wanted to do, like if he wanted to start a business, or that's what I want for him. Things that he was never able to do, that now he can. He has the freedom to do. And I just want him to be happy, have a good job. You know, he doesn't have to struggle anymore. He doesn't have to worry about money. He doesn't have to worry about this. Everyone's always going to have a little bit of that, but I honestly want him to be healthy and happy and just enjoy his life now. Just enjoy his life.
People have to give formerly incarcerated people a chance. Naturally, a lot of them aren't going to stay out or stay out of trouble. But Frankie wants to improve his life, which he's been working. He just can't seem to get ahead right now, but he will. He's that kind of person. That's all I want for him, is to have the rest of his life to be a good life.
I'm happy Frankie's home, and I have a better relationship with him. We get along well. He comes here when he can because he works a lot. He works very long days. So he is working. He has his own place, and I'm glad for that. He's still trying to get on his feet. He's struggling. But all in all, he's a good person. He helps me when I need him. He's helped me move a few times. He's helped me fix things. And we, you know, we get along good, and I'm happy he's home, and I am happy he's trying to get his life on track. And I hope that one day he can be truly happy.
You know, I'm getting older, so now I'm going to get ailments. So now, you know, I don't know how many years I got left to live where I can enjoy life, because I missed out on so many years, you know, of doing things. You know, I still feel like I'm 21, but I'm 53. Knees hurt, shoulders hurt. Everything hurts. So, time's limited.
I'm very lucky to have a brother like him that is there to be here for all the occasions and all the family functions, and just have a relationship with him one-on-one instead of behind bars.